I'm the best in the world.
What I'd like to have right now.
Yes! Yes! Yes!
Because I was lying for that was cool.
Are you ready?
It doesn't matter!
Oh, I said, are you ready?
I'm a sexy beast, baby!
I was up all night!
And I'm...
Welcome, everybody, to For Life Podcast. I'm your host, Bosch, alongside
Lord Cheyenne Hayes on this Tuesday night Titans edition of the For Life Podcast. I'm excited. It's Tuesday.
Yeah, we're usually doing this on Sunday, yeah. But...
well, it's the Lord's Day, so we were being rude for that time period, even though we'll be back this week. And on top of that, despite the holidays, two episodes this week.
Exactly.
Two For Life Podcast episodes this week.
On Saturday?
Yeah, it's Saturday.
It'll be up for Mother's Day.
It'll be up just in time for Mother's Day. So
Mother.
So once you're sick of your mom, you can listen to us and feel better. And you know what else makes me feel better? Having the official For Life Podcast t-shirt. And where can you find that shirt at, Bosch?
It's teesprings.com/forlifepodcast14.
Exactly.
I will put up the link on
exactly. This. And guess what? You can find us on social media, For Life Podcast, when you listen to your podcast, For Life. Get us on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter, at For Life Podcast, /For Life Podcast. Follow us on Instagram. You can follow the Big Bosch Man at...
I am the Bosch.
At both of his Twitter handles and his Instagram. You can follow me on Twitter and on Instagram, at Ravishing Jones, #RavishingJones, or #GigoloJimmyDelRay. On to business. Monday Night Raw. Let's talk about last week so I can be informed, and then I can sound a little bit less informed for this coming week. Last week, I got to start off with the only thing that I got to see, the Bray Wyatt angle.
Yeah.
I enjoyed it.
I did.
Because it was different. It was super different. It was super creepy. But I feel like the person that benefited the most out of that was Bray Wyatt.
Yeah.
Not both people in the feud. Not saying that John Cena had to benefit because obviously he has to look like he's actually fucking scared of something.
Yeah.
But I thought it was super great. But a lot of like... wrestling purists and commentators and stuff like that say that they didn't get it. Mm-hmm. So I actually got their point, but what did you think? I did get the point for people to be like, well, I don't get what that was about.
I thought it was great, actually. I thought it worked. I thought it was different. Not what we usually see, especially from like a dark character like that. It's a different approach to using mind games, especially with Cena's character. He's make a wish and for the kids, and his kids are his fan base while the adults don't like him. So I think it was cool to like put a new twist on that and just to see Cena vulnerable.
My thing is,
but I didn't like that. And then even then Renee tried to interview him later on in the show, and he stood quiet and walked away. Probably one of the best Cena promos ever, because he didn't say a word. But then later on the show he did another promo where he was actually talking and
that goes back to what you keep bringing up about him. Mm-hmm. I don't know why people didn't like... I mean, I get their point, but for them to be like, I don't get it...
Yeah.
I don't know. I know I thoroughly enjoyed it, despite the fact that I've been pretty... not outspoken, but I've been pretty... whatever McFoley's opinions. I do think in certain ways the John Cena character is stale.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the points that he did make that I kind of saw, even though I felt like Mick exaggerated it, you know, he was saying that when Foley's standing there, he's got the armbands, the wristbands, the hat, that he's trying to always sell something.
Yeah.
Me, personally, I've been saying for a little while now that I do think John, first of all, he's a walking marketing machine.
Yeah.
For the WWE. Not in the sense of Chris Jericho, how Jericho's out there hustling. He's his own greatest promoter.
Yeah.
But in the sense of, like, he's just head-to-toe in marketing, John Cena. He's worse than Hogan. Hogan just had a t-shirt and a headband. Yeah. Everything else, he had to go through the catalog or whatever they were selling. But Cena's
got his own
all his regalia on.
He's got a section in Kmart.
Got a section in Kmart now. Everybody has a section in Kmart now. But anyway. First step to me, and I was really hoping that he would do this at the pay-per-view. I was really hoping that he would start wearing wrist tape. I think that would be a huge step, believe it or not.
Yeah.
For him to start wearing wrist tape and maybe like an elbow pad. Mm-hmm. Honestly, like when he had the elbow pad for his injuries, I thought that was great. It was just a cool look for him personally. I know
it makes him look more like a wrestler.
Exactly.
More than like a basketball player. I was thinking the same shit.
Yeah, like, you know, he wears knee pads, which is great.
I just feel like with the shorts, and the sneakers, he already looks like a basketball player. Like, I feel like I can look out your window and see somebody dressed like that playing basketball. Yeah,
like a few years ago at the Japan show, he came out with the Zumba pants and the Rivera jacket, and everybody was like, that's going to be seen as a new look. And I'm like, you don't know anything about wrestling.
Yeah.
But then he also did on Twitter that he wanted to change his look, but he couldn't come up with anything, I guess. I know that I don't...
I mean, he's changed it to, what, khaki shorts or camo shorts?
Khaki and cargo and jean shorts and
I mean, maybe he can go back to wearing the little tights that match whatever city he's in.
Yeah. I mean, I don't want him to wear tights. Okay. I know that. I know I don't want him to wear tights, and I don't...
I think he's too big. Like, I don't know.
Yeah, he's too big. Even when he... Even looking back at the fact that he wore tights is like, whoa, that was actually a good idea.
Yeah.
But I definitely don't want him to wear tights.
Well, at least it's not, as long as he doesn't wear pants like the 2003 Rumble where they were like rolled up at the bottom.
When you wear jorts or that or whatever, wrestling boots isn't really the biggest fit.
Yeah.
And, you know, whatever. I don't know. Me personally, wrist tape and an elbow pad will go a long, long way. My opinion. And tape up one fist.
Yeah.
Triple H ain't around. I don't see that real being a big problem. Anybody who knows anything knows that if Goldust was, you know, not wearing the gloves, he would have that tape fist because he was the first guy in the 90s to have a tape. Like, in the mid-90s of my age, and I remember top of my head, having a tape fist was the natural Dustin Rhodes. So, you know, and then Triple H just took it.
Remember
to
the tape fist match?
Oh, but I think it was Flying Brian and Wyndham.
Yeah.
One of my favorite matches ever. And he gets Wyndham flush before, I mean, he gets...
Didn't Duggan have one too?
No. Oh yeah, Duggan had the tape fist match because that would be his gimmick. He would use a closed fist and he would roll his tape in the air. Oh, and then of course there's the Silver Dollar match. You remember that?
Yeah.
Have you seen that on the network recently?
Oh, I haven't seen it.
Yeah, the Silver Dollar match with Big Man Ray Traylor and John Tenta, God rest his soul. And I actually, because of course I've been watching Clash of the Champions, we'll get into that in a minute. It was on a Nitro, but they showed the repackage. Luger hit one of Harlem Heat. I think it was Booker. No, it was Stevie.
Yeah.
With a closed fist, and he had the roll of quarters. Mm-hmm. But you just saw pennies and quarters all over the ring. He must have clocked them hard. It was a loose roll. But, so that was my opinion on John Cena and stuff like that. If you were to make over John Cena,
I feel like it's been the same look for the last decade, so I don't even know how I would repackage him.
I mean, is it the same concept as, well, I mean, that's what works? Is it like, oh, well, then if you're going to change him, why is Taker wearing the singlet? Why having Triple H?
I don't know. I don't know what I would change him to.
Exactly. Like I said, I just think wrist tape and an elbow pad would go a long way.
I just feel like even his body frame, it's weird. Like, I don't know. I just can't imagine seeing him wearing something else.
Yeah.
Even if he was, like, wearing jeans or pants or... I feel like his upper body's so massive. Yeah.
You know what I actually think? Like, we know John Cena's strong, but I don't think he showcases his physique enough. Mm-hmm. To be honest with you, even though this would probably cause an IWC field day for him, why doesn't he wear, like, a fitted t-shirt instead of the baggy one? Not saying that, you know, that he's wearing a huge t-shirt like the jerseys back in the day, but I'm going to go on a limb and say that John Cena is either a large or an extra large.
Yeah.
And we all know how the WWE t-shirts run. Mm-hmm. I know he's wearing the next size up.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So, that's my opinion. What else did I miss for last week's Raw?
There was the Kane coming up from under the ring, a la 1997.
Whenever
Bryan used the wrench, it kind of reminded me of that angle with Vader.
Yeah, I saw that in the video package. I like that.
Yeah.
I like that. Was it the gimmicked wrench like the other one with Vader?
It didn't bend.
Oh, thank God. Because the one with Vader just turned to aluminum foil.
Yeah.
Last week was the Flair thing, right?
Oh, God.
Yeah, exactly. I wasn't.
Did you see that?
Was that at the end of the third hour? Was that what closed the show?
At like 11.
That was what closed the show.
It was right before the Orton-Roman match.
So Flair did what he did, which we'll get into in a minute. He walks out and the bell rings.
Yes.
And then that's when the big melee closes the show.
Yeah.
Still bad.
I mean...
What happened after Orton Roman match? That I saw on YouTube last week. It's just not coming to me.
This was my opinion maybe last week when I was under the impression that Evolution would win at the pay-per-view before they had the great match that they did. I thought that a possible idea could have been Flair comes out, endorses the Shield, he's going to be in their corner, and I guess maybe when, like, they're going to go, let's say they're going to go for, like, the triple power bomb on Triple H, Flair comes up, low blow, then the other two guys take out those two guys, and Triple H hits the pedigree and wins, and Flair helps Evolution, and then builds to another match.
Right.
Where the Shield would win, or maybe to, like, possible, the War Games or whatever, like, I mean, they ended up having a great match anyway in Evolution. I mean, Shield won.
Due to reports on this weekend, I kind of get...
I mean, I think that would have worked a little better than what they did, but, I mean... I feel like that was more like, okay, here's Flair, shut up.
Right.
You got him.
Well...
He's not with us. Okay.
Plus, he didn't... You know, they were in St. Louis, mm-hmm. where Flair is in that Harley Race status.
Yeah.
Due to the NWA and the Mid-Atlantic days. Mm-hmm. You know, when that Woo comes on in that first try, that gets a great pop. After that, because of the type of song he has, it kind of dies down. So I don't know if I would have put Flair for the third hour.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't know if I would have put the Shield Evolution angle at the end, because that's not the main event for my pay-per-view.
Yeah.
Not saying that match wasn't important or whatever, but that's just me. Then again, I don't think Kane and Bryan might have gotten me the best ratings to close the quarter hour either. I don't know.
I mean, also with them ripping through the ring, that could have also closed.
Yeah, that could have also closed and then fade to black, whatever. But, it was... Flair's entrance was cool and the camaraderie was cool, but then for him to say what he said, I just didn't see the what if. I didn't see how it benefited the feud. Mm-hmm. I didn't see how it benefited
Shield. I don't think it was meant to benefit anything. I think it was meant to just shut up all the fans that were complaining that Flair wasn't there.
And
I think for all that, they would have been better off just not using him at all.
Agreed. Totally agreed. And then they didn't fly him in for the pay-per-view in Jersey. It wasn't like he came out, helped Shield, or helped Evolution, or was it ringside and then left.
I think that the sole purpose was just to, for everybody that complained that he wasn't there, like, okay, here he is. And then to make all those people that wanted him there be like, okay, we really didn't need him.
Because I know people were getting pissy that he didn't come out yet, right? Mm-hmm. Towards the end of the show. And then
at one point, I was like, okay, he's not going to come out, but I know they had already advertised it.
Right, well, Triple H spoiled it on Twitter, which I would have never done. Mm-hmm. I would have left it as dirt sheets leaking it.
Yeah.
But I didn't see any benefit of that at all. And apparently, rumors are that Flair has an offer on the table. He has to dot his I's, cross his T's, and get his house in order. We'll see what happens.
All right. I know.
We'll see.
I know you're a huge Flair fan.
Yeah.
But I want your honest opinion.
Uh huh.
Do you think it's fair that he was offered a contract but nothing for JR?
Oh no. But here's my take on that whole situation is different.
Mm-hmm.
Why are either of them in trouble?
Yeah.
I'm not saying
But I feel like JR is getting the work. Okay, I know JR is doing his thing right now, and he's.
Oh, no, without question. JR is getting the shittier end of the stick. Mm-hmm. And when we saw him at Access, we were like, holy shit, JR's there.
Yeah.
Because JR had
the show.
The two shows at House of Blues.
Yeah.
You know, he was doing outside events. So when he came out with Heyman, people were leaving lines to go meet him. And then he said, you know, he wasn't at WrestleMania because he wasn't booked. He wasn't asked to stay. Do I think it's fair? Absolutely not. Here's my thing. What do you do with Flair? What do you do with JR at this point?
Mm-hmm.
I do genuinely... If JR is down helping in NXT when he was, before they launched the network, why wasn't Michael Cole?
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? And plus, Michael Cole's the guy doing it right now.
Yeah.
Not saying JR's the best of all time. His knowledge is invaluable, but so is Michael Cole's.
Mm-hmm.
He's been doing it for a while now, almost 20 years, 15 years, whatever it is now. But I definitely don't think it's fair.
Mm-hmm.
But at the same time, it's a double-edged sword because WWE, minus when JR told the story about Vince and Briscoe and he told it wrong,
yeah,
WWE hasn't bashed JR like the other times when he was gone or this or that.
I thought that the midget playing Michael Cole looked more like JR than he did like Michael Cole.
I still haven't even seen the pre-show, and I heard it was amazing.
They did say Slobberknocker. I think he said Slobberknocker at one point.
Well, you know, but that's
But it wasn't like it was. They were like, "Wait, we don't say that." Or yeah. It was like a harmless one. Yeah, it wasn't like
compared to other stuff like Dr. Heine. But you know, it's not right. But WWE, you know, still sells his products. Yeah. It wasn't like once they released him, oh well, we're not going to sell your stuff anymore. You know, we're not going to sell the autographs. We're not going to sell the cookbooks, the beef jerky, you know, the sausages, whatever they got going on. But I definitely don't think JR has been treated right since the scenario.
Yeah.
You can, if somebody says, oh, well, that's a Triple H thing, I kind of get that. Mm-hmm. But, you know, JR and Triple H are pretty tight, too.
Yeah.
You know,
and Triple H has always been, like, stuck up for JR.
Yeah, so, and so's Taker, so's Michaels. Mm-hmm. But, you know, some people have also said on the internet, I remember a writer that got released, when he started, he was wondering why JR kept getting like
treated
terribly, and his answer was, "Well, then I met the guy and I understood." So I don't know.
Well, I hear that tomorrow's Ross report is going to be Shawn Michaels, and he's going to tell the story of his reaction sitting in Gorilla during the streak ending.
Oh,
so I know JR said on the Law that it was an interesting interview.
Well, I mean, and I the first tweet that I sent JR before he wrote to me the second time was, you know, will we ever see Flair on the Raw support? And he didn't write back to me. So, I don't know. He says he hasn't seen Flair since SummerSlam.
Yeah.
I was at Access. If he did see Flair, it was at the Hall of Fame.
Yeah.
Because their timetables didn't match. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Because I think I met Heyman and JR on Sunday, and Flair was there Saturday night.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I don't know, but it's not fair to JR. That's me. You know, I mean, God bless him. He's still working. He's still doing a bunch of stuff.
Yeah.
But then at the same time, JR has said on a regular basis, I don't miss traveling. I don't miss the job that comes with the commentating.
Yeah.
So, in theory, regardless of how bad it went before he decided no longer to do commentary, who's to say he wouldn't have retired a year after that episode?
Yeah.
Or 2 years, you know? I don't know. Do I think JR can... Triple H is in charge of talent relations right now, too.
Yeah.
And he's just got guys like Briscoe, like Regal scouting, versus JR was doing tons of different stuff, like scouting and signing and this and that.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I don't think they were going to hire JR to do talent relations, the job he had 10 years ago.
Yeah.
I don't think he would want that job, especially since, you know, they had just gotten rid of Johnny Ace. So to put JR back, I think that would have been an insult to both of them.
Yeah.
Because they got rid of JR from that position for Johnny Ace. They felt Johnny Ace would have been better. Yeah. But, so yeah. I don't know, but I definitely don't think that it was fair.
Yeah.
You know, again, my opinion, but I definitely think we'll see JR on a WWE screen again.
Yeah.
You know. Not as soon as everybody wants, you know, but, you know, yeah.
I mean, at least for the network. Or...
Yeah, for the network. He still does the DVD interviews. He was recently filmed for...
the Heyman one.
For the Heyman one. It would appear as if there's interviews for the Oh My God, WCW's Most Shocking Moments DVD.
What do you think is going to be number one? Arquette?
I don't know. I don't think there's 50 Oh My God moments.
I think it's
WWE caliber Oh My God moments?
I think it's more. It might be number one will probably be Vince buying WCW.
That's not fair. It has to be like a homebred moment.
I think that's going to be number one. And I think...
You know what I think?
I think Arquette might be like in that top
three. Arquette's going to be one. Shockmaster's going to be two.
No. The top three, and I don't know in what order, but it's going to be Arquette winning the belt, Vince buying WCW, and Hogan joining the NWO.
Oh, yeah, that's easy.
Those are the top three.
That's easy. You know what I think is actually going to be on there? Just because of the way the WWE one was, when the lights went out during the Starrcade 93 promo.
Mm-hmm.
Pay-per-view, rather.
Yeah.
The Dustin and Austin wrestled in the dark.
Mm-hmm.
That'll be on there. And it was on the WWE one had it when it happened in your house,
Beware
right?
Beware of Dog.
Yeah, Beware of Dog. So, I was just there like, are there 50 shocking WCW moments? Oh, you know what's going to be on there, right? The Demon.
Oh, I'm sure there's going to be a lot be of those on there. Shitty gimmicks.
The Demon will be on there. Oh, God. I just can't think of 50. Mm-hmm. 50. I can think of what the fuck moments. What, well,
I can think of,
oh,
like,
God.
Hall, like, Hall coming in.
Hall coming in.
Sting. Turning dark.
Turning.
Like, dark
turning
side.
To the Crow.
Yeah.
Flair leaving. Could even be on there.
The Horsemen
was a big
reuniting.
Deal. The Horsemen reuniting. Heading turning on the Horsemen. That was a big deal. Mm-hmm. That was a big deal when it happened.
Luger showing up on Nitro.
Luger showing up Medusa. On Nitro. Medusa throwing the belt in the trash can. Bret Hart getting speared by Goldberg with the steel plate.
Rick Rude on Nitro and
Rick
Raw.
Rick Rude on both shows.
Goldberg winning the belt.
Mike Awesome jumping ship.
Mm-hmm.
Mike Awesome jumping ship will be on there. The streak ending will be on there. Bash of the Beach 2000. Conversation over.
Yeah.
That there's like four moments from that pay-per-view alone. From that pay-per-view alone. Oh, there was another pay-per-view that I was watching on the network. I can't remember what it was. WCW, of course.
Yeah.
And the announcers had no idea what was going on. Had no... Oh! Me and Malik were just talking about it. Sting and Hogan, where Hogan laid down.
Yeah.
That one. That's gotta be over. And the announcers are like, clueless! Clueless. But, yeah, I think we should fast forward to this week's Raw now.
Okay. Oh, we're going to skip the pay-per-view?
Oh. Yeah.
Well, you want to talk about it when we come back?
No, let's do the Raw. When we come back, we'll get our... we'll cross our I's, dot our T's. And, yeah.
He's got the whole world in his hands. He's got the whole world. He's got the whole world in his hands. He's got the whole world in his hands. He's got you and me, brother, in his hands. He's got you and me, brother, in his hands. He's got you and me, brother, in his hands. He's got the whole world in his hands. He's got you and me, sister, in his hands. He's got you and me, sister, in his hands. He's got you and me, sister, in his hands. He's got the whole world in his hands. He's got the itty bitty baby in his hands. He's got the itty bitty baby in his hands. He's got the itty bitty baby in his hands. He's got the whole world in his hands.
That's right. We've got all you listeners in our hands. Let's talk pay-per-view. I gave it out of 10, 7.5.
Like a 6.
No pun intended. Yeah, 7's fine. No pun intended. I give it a B+.
Mm-hmm.
I thought it was like a solid pay-per-view. It was definitely well-rounded, not to say it didn't have its flaws. The opening contest was great. Well, you should talk about the pre-show first, because that's the only thing I haven't seen yet.
I thought the pre-show was funny. They had midget announcers, referee,
yeah,
ring announcer.
Quite entertaining.
It was pretty entertaining. It was it was supposed to be there was a few spots that, like, I feel like if any of the old-time wrestlers would have seen it, they would have flipped.
Yeah.
Like, there's a spot where Hornswoggle's, like, gonna go, like, jump through the ropes, so, like, everybody's waiting for him to catch him. And, like, I guess he, like, bumps into the ropes and falls off.
Oh, I saw that on the replay, yeah.
And, everybody's looking like they were waiting for him to catch him. So, and then there was the other spot where he's on top of the little ladder.
Oh, and Torito's telling him to jump.
And Torito tells him, he gets up, tells him to jump, lays down, Hornswoggle jumps, and he rolls out the way. I thought it was just, like, as far as, like, those people that still believe in kayfabe or want to keep kayfabe alive, that completely killed it. I mean, it was meant to be comedic, but
yeah. I don't think that's terrible, but I get the purists, you know, the old school guys.
I think they could have done without those two spots. I think without just, hey, I'm waiting for you to land on me.
Yeah.
You know, there was one spot where, like, Drew McIntyre did, like, a flip over the rope and he went clear and, like, took a bump on the table. That was pretty impressive.
Okay.
Hornswoggle did an elbow drop onto the announce table, the little announce table. Uh-huh. Then there was one crazy spot where who was, I think the Matadors were holding up one of the 3MB guys, okay. And Cerrito did his move where he jumps on them, and okay. they landed back on like a bunch of ladders and tables, and
ooh.
It was almost like TLC Extreme, yeah.
Oh, we all see Extreme. Yeah, it sounded entertaining.
The opening match was the triple threat elimination.
It was a three-way dance, old school, and I thought having Heyman there was pretty cool because, you know, ECW originated the three-way dance.
Yeah.
And
it was in Jersey.
I liked it. Mm-hmm. It was a big win for Cesaro, especially pinning RVD.
Yeah.
I think a lot of fans were upset that he didn't get neutralized face first on the can, but I think that was because of, you know, the scratch that RVD got on his eye or forehead or whatever it was. Because, you know, he hit that trash can hard.
Yeah.
I felt bad for Swagger, you know, and then I felt worse for him the next time on
Raw.
But we'll get into that in a bit. what was after that? Was that not the Divas?
No, Divas was second to last.
Yeah, second to last.
It wasn't, was the Intercontinental?
Yeah, it was the IC, I think. It was Barrett and Langston, which was a pretty decent match.
Mm-hmm.
Pretty decent match, and Barrett got the win, which we all wanted. Now it's just a matter of, okay, make it relevant.
I feel like we go through this anytime the belt changes hands. Oh, let's hope it's relevant. Let's hope that they bring the belt up and they make the belt relevant and they push the guy, and it doesn't happen. So, I mean,
well,
it's one of those where, I mean, I think Barrett's pretty over. I mean, a lot of, I think Big E, that's not saying that, okay, Big E was pretty over when he beat Axel
a couple months. He got a real good reaction.
And then look how he's being booked now, like.
Well, I have to say, if I have more confidence with Barrett,
than Big E.
Okay. I have to say that. What did Barrett do on Raw?
They had a rematch.
Yes. Was it good?
It was pretty good. Same.
Same shit. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, I think it's also a matter of, okay, well, who's next in line?
Yeah.
You know, that's another thing. Keep it in contention. Keep, you know, whether he's getting...
I think because we grew up, especially during the era where, like, the Intercontinental title meant something.
That
like,
was the, me, you know, that was the workhorse title.
For me, like, I grew up watching Razor and Shawn having battles for it in ladder matches.
Yeah.
And then guys like Bulldog, Owen.
Owen, Bulldog, you Goldust, know, and then in the 2000 era, even so.
Even,
you know,
like, when Hunter and Rock were fighting for
him. Yeah, and, like, that was great at the Garden. And even in the 2000 era, we had, you know, we had Angle, we had Jericho, we had Guerrero, we had Benoit, we had Billy Gunn.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we had Val Venus, who was, like, the king of the mid-card in the Attitude Era. D'Lo, you know, there was so many guys that were just busting their butt.
Jeff Jarrett Edge,
you know, for that belt. You know, so I feel more confident with Barrett restoring what's left of it than Big E. We actually skipped the match. It was the Rusev squash.
Oh, that was second? I thought it was
that after. That was right after.
I mean,
it was what it was, but I would have rathered that Rusev...
I would rather the camera just stay on Lana.
Oh, my Christ. But I didn't see the point of that fallaway slam to the outside after the match was done.
Yeah.
Like, the match was a squash. It wasn't even 3 minutes, looking at Wikipedia. But if he would have just, like, threw Woods into the stairs, then did that.
Yeah.
And or did that, caught True for the kick, you know, whatever. Should have been shorter. But,
I mean, in all honesty, I think he's a racist.
What?
He beat Kofi last night. That's what everybody's saying. He only beats up black people.
So are you saying that in his next booking, he will be taking on an African-American superstar?
I think if Darren Young wasn't injured, he would have been next on the list.
Okay.
Well, Titus is a heel.
Uh-huh.
Then there's Henry and Big E. Those are pretty even.
Thank God this is in 96, because then Farooq Asad would have had a field day with this.
Taken out the nation.
He would have taken out. He would have been more over than Ahmed.
He would have taken out Ahmed and the Nation.
Yeah, and it would not have been black on black like the Nation and Ahmed's feud. And then after Barrett and Big E was Shield and Evolution. I mean, I was watching it and I was like, huh, Batista didn't get the memo that black was the color. But of course, orange was the new black. Yeah, he looked like a peach.
I don't even know what to
I gotta bring it up every time. He's got the same back tattoo as one of my favorite porn stars. This bothers me every time.
It's a pretty tattoo. It's flowers and stars and
shut up. The excitement was in the air.
Yeah.
And the psychology was A+. It was old school. The crowd was into it. I love that they took the fight outside. It had been a while since it was that caliber of intensity and physicality. Yeah. Rollins jumping from the stand was great.
Did you catch when Triple H was looking up waiting for him?
Yeah, I caught that. And Ambrose was just... He was something on that match, man.
Yeah.
He was on 11.
Mm-hmm.
He was something funny. He was great. And then Reigns got his shine. Mm-hmm. It was nice to see all three of them get burned.
Yeah.
It was just nice to see all three of them finally get an equal amount of presentation.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, Roman was going to get the win, which I knew was going to happen had they won.
Yeah.
But it was just nice to see all three of them get burned.
Mm-hmm.
You know, not... One looked weaker, not weaker, but, you know, no one outshined the other.
Yeah, no, definitely.
You know, that's my opinion. So
I thought that was definitely the match of the night.
Yeah, definitely match of the night. Wyatt and Cena, which actually was longer by 2 minutes. I'll let you go first.
I had to run down to the store, so I missed, like, the first half of the match. So I came back, and I know, like, I saw when he brought the two members in. I thought it was a decent match. I don't think it was.
I thought it was. This is my thing. It's that was a.
I mean, I did it. I don't know. I guess people are indifferent about the ending, or like, I thought it was good. I thought it continued from Monday. I thought the kid was creepy as fuck.
Yeah, I liked the ending. I don't know why a lot of people didn't, including some of the old schoolers. While creatively speaking, it was different.
Mm-hmm.
You know, well, if you come out of the cage, you've got the lions waiting for you. But there was too much interference.
Yeah.
I didn't necessarily mind having one guy in the cage and one guy out, because that would, again, everything that they did was, in fact, different.
Well, I know Rowan was on top of the cage when...
Yeah, Rowan was on top at one point, and then Luke was in there for about 6-7 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
Everything that they did was different.
Yeah.
But I won't say it wasn't annoying.
Mm-hmm.
I won't say that either. Decent match. Great ending. I enjoyed it. Some people didn't. But I liked it. I think it helped Bray Wyatt the most. Mm-hmm. Clearly, they're going to keep going, which I am enjoying. Even though last night they did nothing for that, right?
Right. Wyatt came out and cut a promo.
On Cena.
Yeah, and Cena's supposed to be cutting one on Main Event.
Right. Next up is Paige and Tamina. I thought the match was okay.
Mm-hmm.
There were some awkward moments, like when Tamina, I don't know if she was buying Paige time, but she was kind of like pandering to one particular point of the crowd, and she kept saying, what? And I was like, oh, she's trying to call her spot. I was like, if she keeps saying what,
she kept
like
yelling
that,
out, like, where are you?
Yeah, she kept yelling, where are you? And,
I don't know if she was looking for AJ or...
Or if she kept saying, the one that stands out in my mind the most was Paige was down and she kept saying what?
Mm-hmm.
So I'm like, oh, well, she can't hear what Paige is saying. She don't know what's next or whatever's going on. So it was a little awkward at times, but it was cool.
Yeah.
I think it was great for Paige to get the Scorpion Crosslock as a win.
Yeah, especially because Tamina's so much bigger than her.
I
think I didn't have a problem with the match. I think it's just been so long since Tamina's really been like...
Yeah.
She's been used as like Vicky's bodyguard and then AJ's bodyguard.
So for
like,
her to just wrestle... Yeah. I mean, it did nothing for either of them.
Yeah.
Not that the match was... bad all around, but it did nothing for either of them, I feel like. And then, of course, Kane and Bryan. Okay. I enjoyed the Kane and Bryan match.
Okay.
Was it what I wanted it to be? No. But I knew that going in. Here was my thing. And I'm going to compare it to the other time it was done. When you do a forklift spot, I'm not saying it's been done all the time, but it has to be quick.
Yeah.
When Brock Lesnar did it to Big Show, he fucking ripped that stage apart.
Yeah.
And he went full speed ahead.
Mm-hmm.
Daniel Bryan took forever to load Kane. And then again, he's smaller and bigger and blah, 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 the ratio. Took forever for him to get on the forklift took forever for him to start it, took forever for him to lift Kane up, took forever for him to drive it into the arena.
Why? You try putting me on a forklift and driving me around.
No, right, but I'm gonna. But guess what? Once I get you on the damn thing, I'm gonna go 90 miles an hour on the forklift, right?
Yeah.
So that was, and it's true.
And then even just like the lifting, and then Kane slowly rolling off.
Don't even. Like, that disengages the crowd when you take that long to get into the arena.
I think the fact that they were that long.
You're on a vehicle.
I think the fact that, I mean, they were disengaged prior to that because they were backstage for so long.
Yeah, they were.
It was quiet.
But, I mean, it was good what they were doing backstage. Yeah. It was.
I like the spot where he launched that gas tank
into
the windshield.
I was like, Kane is in the Olympics with the Trunch Bowl. He did that fantastically. I want the car to blow up, of course, my violent self.
Yeah.
And then, of course, when Kane threw himself... And it wasn't like he Mick Foley threw himself off the forklift. He just safely...
He, like, rolled off.
Yeah, like, no. I would have rolled naturally. Then again, I'm smaller, so I would have flown to the outside.
The flying headbutt was pretty cool.
That was cool, and I think that made up for a lot in terms of, like, where the crowd was lost and blank. I enjoyed the ending.
Even though,
I'm waiting for Kane to be in a handicap match against those two ring attendants. That's what I'm waiting for. I enjoy the ending... But then when Kane sat up, did the pyro gimmick, I was like, that just killed the match. And not saying the match wasn't good or bad. You know, it was indifferent. But,
well, if
again,
we thought that made Daniel Bryan look weak, then we had another thing coming.
Exactly. But, you know, I was like, okay, that's great that... I remember I said, well, that they better be feuding. They better continue after this. This better not be just a transitional for Batista.
Yeah.
You know, I was like, this better keep on going. But I did think, like, okay, when they wrestle again, he has to literally take him out. But go figure, that's probably what's going to happen.
Buried alive.
When they wrestle again, because now they're going to go buried
alive.
So
when he comes back, will he have his mask or not?
Will he have his mask or not? Or
I think now it's just getting to the point where it's just annoying, where he just keeps switching back and forth.
Now it's got to be like, dude, keep the mask.
Yeah.
You want to change the look. That's fine, but keep the
mask. But I thought
the
whole point of him taking the mask off was because of the See No Evil 2 movie. And then he put it back on, and the movie still hasn't come out yet.
Oh, well, I think it was just while he was filming. While he was filming, I mean...
I thought the point was to have him be recognizable when the movie comes out and have him without the mask.
Oh, well, let's see what happens.
May 19th?
Well, you know how I am with that date. I'm not answering any calls that date. So there was an angle on Monday Night Raw. What happened before the parking lot?
Okay. Earlier in the night, they were in their locker room, Brie and Daniel Bryan.
Oh, because he's a champion. They get their own locker room now. Okay, good for them. No, I'm kidding.
There was a banging on the door.
Uh-huh.
And then Stephanie comes in. She's like, oh, I'm sorry. I have heavy hands. I'm not making this shit up. Then she's like, okay, last night you awoke in something in the Demon Kane.
Okay.
You guys should just stay put here so that nothing happens. And Danny Brown's like, okay, I'll stay here. It's fine. And then, like, the door closes. Bree's like, oh my God, look! And there's, like, the Kane mask is on the door. Then, like, later on, they're still in the locker room. They stayed put because Brian listened to Stephanie.
Okay.
Then the lights go out, Bree's screaming, then the mask is on, like, a lamp, and the lamp is lighting up, so they leave the locker room.
Wait, why was the mask on a lamp? First of all, that is a fire hazard.
Then they leave the locker room, and I guess they're not looking, and they bump into Stephanie, and Stephanie's like, okay, I'll get your car, but you need to have a match, or else you'll be stripped of your title, it's a breach of contract.
I'll get your car, and I'll
get your car.
Mess up that wire inside.
I'll get your car, and it'll be waiting for you once your match ends, and you guys can leave after your match. Okay, so he has the match with Del Rio. Pretty long match, but it was a pretty decent match. He wins. The Kane pyro goes off. They run away. They run up the ramp, they go to the car. They get in the car.
Right.
Then there's a segment that I sent you.
The car starts. Daniel Bryan is compelled to check underneath the hood.
And Bree's rushing him.
Reconnects the wire. The hood comes down.
Hurry up!
Hook comes down. Kane's in the back seat. Where to, Bree? And then, of course, Bryan goes in. They start whatever. Let me tell you something. Kane fell so hard on that concrete. When I saw that, I was like, why couldn't you do that off the forklift, you bastard? So, yeah.
Well, it also, they didn't show on camera when Kane fell off the car.
You heard it, and it was pretty bad.
Which makes me think that he didn't really fall that hard.
Oh, no, I believe it. Still real to me.
Huh?
I think it was them. Still real to me.
And so was that swanton that Jeff Hardy gave Umaga a few years back.
Outside. Oh, well, that was... cocaine's a hell of a drug. This was what drove me the most insane.
And that's considering you didn't even see the previous two segments.
Right. We need to find it and then put creepy horror music to it. That's what we need to do and make a movie out of it. Kane gets out to check the body. What is he, Jason Voorhees? No.
Brian gets out.
Yeah, Brian, excuse me, gets out and check the body. This isn't a horror movie. This is real life.
It made him look...
Yeah, he goes to check the body, then he backs away.
I think this has probably been the worst Brian's looked
in years. So, again, my thing was, that is not an angle for the WWE champion.
Exactly.
The WWE champion cannot show weakness. He can get his ass beat, he can get tarred and feathered, he can be in handicap matches every week.
The fact that he ran away to begin with, I didn't like. I think...
He stood in his room all night.
Exactly. Like Stephanie said, stay in your room to be safe. Okay, I'll stay here. I don't want anything
to happen. The WWE champion cannot cower.
Exactly. Unless he's a heel. And he's not a heel. He's supposed to be the biggest baby face.
Exactly.
The fighting champion.
Exactly.
I beat all three members of Evolution at WrestleMania.
He beat the McMahon family. He beat all three members of Evolution
one night.
He stood up and took over Raw. But he's afraid of Kane? Like I told you, he should be kicking Kane's ass.
Exactly.
So
at least try. I think even if he would have put up a fight and got his ass kicked, I would have been fine with that.
Right.
If he didn't run away at all. If he said, fuck this, I'm going to go look for Kane, I'm going to get in his face, and if he kicks my ass, I'll get back up.
What I will say is that...
But instead...
I also think this is an easy way out.
He runs away. He does something to get the upper... Okay, I put him through a flaming table, or I run... He falls off a car... And then he still gets up at the end.
But
so
also
Kane's
remember,
the one looking strong.
Also remember, the idea box is a lot thinner, Bosh, because this is not 1999, so the next logical step is, oh, okay, I didn't beat you. Wait till I see your girlfriend.
Mm-hmm.
That's not going to happen.
Yeah.
It doesn't even happen in the video games now. You can't touch the girls.
Exactly.
You know, so I don't know. I do think that last night's Raw were major shots at both the Daniel Bryan and the John Cena characters.
Mm-hmm.
And I hope that next week redeems that.
Yeah.
That's all I have to say about that.
But even then, Cena, you can do whatever to Cena and he'll be fine. But Daniel Bryan's in, like, a weird spot.
No, I don't think having him... I know it was also because he was promoting stuff and then he came out for the dark match. But I don't think John Cena benefited last night. He didn't get the Daniel Bryan treatment.
He wasn't
and
on
of
Raw.
Course, yeah, of course. He didn't get what Daniel Bryan got. And of course, he's likely going to bounce right back from it.
Oh, yeah.
But... I don't know. That Daniel Bryan needs to redeem himself next week. He needs to go looking for Kane.
Exactly.
That's what I'm saying. Now, here's the thing. Did the crowd go wild last night for Monday Night Raw? Because it didn't go wild for Adam Rose.
Not really.
Dirt Sheets say that the live crowd took it better than it seemed on TV.
Probably. I mean, it was just... I mean, I'm watching... I watch on my iPad, so I don't get... It's not... as loud for me, but it didn't seem like he got... I mean, I did hear the audience singing the song.
Yeah.
So...
Do you think the entrance works better in a smaller arena? Because I was thinking about that.
Oh, yeah, because on NXT, it looks like it fills up the whole
ramp.
On Raw,
I was thinking about that when it was happening, and I was like, hmm.
On Raw, it doesn't look as impressive because it's a Raw... Like, I can't imagine him doing it at Mania.
Right.
That's even if he's...
No, I disagree with you, because if it's at Mania, imagine how epic that entrance would be.
That means that
if he's like a big mid-carder even, that entrance at Mania would be amazing.
Even Fandango had a good entrance last
year. So
I think, but then like WWE would have to go all out and kind of like the Cena entrance where he had all the Cenas dressed up like him.
WWE will ask the crowd to dress up like Rosebuds.
Yeah.
And the whole crowd will be singing the damn thing.
Yeah, but I'm saying on Raw last night it didn't look as impressive as it did when I first
saw
it on NXT.
When I first saw NXT, it was hilarious.
Yeah.
But I do think it was a bad thing for him not to wrestle.
Mm-hmm. I thought he was going to have a match. I thought he was going to wrestle Jack Swagger.
Yeah. And well, he will next week, probably.
I mean, when I noticed that it was like the second to last segment, and I noticed Jack Swagger came out. I realized, okay, Adam Rose hasn't come out yet. He's the only heel. I thought it was gonna be like Sandow.
Oh,
we didn't even bring up that Sandow shit from last week.
That says a lot, doesn't it? It was Magneto, and he did it again on SmackDown. I saw. He was wearing a pajama.
That's what he was wearing on Raw.
Footy thing. That's the. I mean, yeah, but hopefully Adam Rose has a better shot next week and wrestles and stuff like that. But it can't be like the most comedic match, in my view, especially taking on Jack Swagger. I feel so bad for Swagger.
Yeah.
Honestly, especially after meeting him.
I wasn't expecting it to be. I thought it was going to be Sandow.
How do you feel about the new U.S. champion?
I mean, it hasn't been like Dean Ambrose is like what 2 weeks shy of having it a year.
Yeah. But I mean, still the longest reign in WWE history.
Yeah, but I mean, he wasn't really defending it, so I mean, maybe if at least Sheamus defends it and it leads to a heel turn for Sheamus, he was teasing a heel turn, right. Like.
Right.
I heard he fell asleep during the.
He says he didn't, but I heard that too.
Yeah.
I don't know which part to believe.
I mean, if it leads to a heel turn, if it leads to something interesting with his character, because God knows his character hasn't been interesting in the last couple years. If it leads to something, I don't know, or maybe even like
I don't like Sheamus as a heel, though. Or maybe I genuinely think Sheamus is better as a babyface.
I mean, considering the great match that Sheamus and Barrett had a few weeks ago, I wouldn't even mind. If they were going to go with this whole unification idea, I wouldn't mind if it's those two to unify it.
I think they should just feud versus unifying the belts.
Mm-hmm.
That's like, oh, well, the U.S. title's better than the IC yeah. title. That benefits both guys.
Yeah.
That benefits both belts, and that benefits the fans. And that's, you know, benefit, you know, that's different for each of those guys.
Who did you think was going to walk out U.S. champion last
week? When I heard the Battle Royal?
Yeah.
Honestly, I thought Ambrose was going to retain.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't know who was in it. I didn't get to see it. But when you told me that, I thought Ambrose was going to retain.
All the guys, they ganged up throughout Big Show, and then they all ganged up and throughout Henry.
Oh. When you told me that, I thought that was going to close. I thought Ambrose was going to retain, and then I thought Evolution was going to kick their ass.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I thought was the closing. Yeah. So it would have been the opener and the close in one segment. That's how I envisioned it to be. But obviously, something totally different happened. What else did I see? So we talked about the Cody Rhodes thing with Ryback, but let's not. What was up with Paige yesterday? Anything happened with Paige?
I don't know. She wasn't on Raw.
That's a bad idea.
I don't remember seeing her.
Well, then again, she's probably on main event tonight.
Probably.
Nothing else besides Cena has been advertised, right?
Yeah, that's the only thing that they mentioned.
Raw didn't sound like a good show.
I was like dozing off at certain points. I think just the main event saved it. The Battle Royal was okay, and the main event was good because it's the Wyatts and the Shields, so right. Of course it was good. Everything else was just like, eh.
Yeah, Raw didn't seem like a good show, to be honest with you. I don't know. I just know I'm probably gonna miss this week too because that's just a way of life.
Yeah.
But I'm not gonna be like everybody else and say, "Oh, WWE doesn't know what they're doing." Da, 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 da. But you know that this time period between now and SummerSlam, for the WWE champion is very crucial. Just like Mick Foley said in his blog, and I had to bring this up. Not. When Benoit won the belt, and yes, I said his name for those of you who know me. When Benoit won the belt at WrestleMania 20, 80% of the people were like, oh, rematch or backlash? He's losing.
Yeah.
But he beat both those guys.
Yes.
The two biggest guys the company had at that time,
yeah.
Considering what was going down.
Probably of all time.
Exactly. And then he kept defending it. And then I remember...
that was back when they were alternating pay-per-views.
Right, but then he beat Shawn Michaels twice.
Then he beat Kane.
And then he beat Kane in a really good match at Bad Blood.
Yeah.
You know,
and then he lost it at SummerSlam.
And then he lost it to Orton. The point is, that reign...
But he wasn't defending it as often back then because it was alternating pay-per-views, so I think...
Not including house shows and all that stuff, Bosh. That's a bigger thing that we realize for a champion.
Yeah.
The point is that he was being showcased. Every single one of his strengths, every single one of his weaknesses being showcased, mostly his strengths. I just hope that
I think putting,
happened yesterday.
Putting Brian
doesn't
in
happen
it,
again.
Brian will be the first to admit that he's not the best on the mic or acting, so putting him in a situation where he has to act is already handicapping
Agreed.
Him.
Agreed.
Like, his strength is in the ring.
Right.
His two strengths is that he's a great technical wrestler, and he seems like a nice fucking guy.
Yeah.
Like, somebody that you can hang out with, but yeah. he's not an actor.
Right.
And neither is Brie.
But when he does cut a good promo, it's because he's very passionate.
And he's being himself.
And he's being himself, and he's being truthful.
He's never going to cut...
Truthful.
He's never
going to
cut a Rock promo.
No, he's not.
You know?
No, he's not. And he's not going to be 300 pounds, unless, you know, the WWE gets
exactly.
rid of their wellness
they needed
policy.
To... I think leading into Mania, they did a better job at building his strengths, which was his heart and determination.
And that he overcomes the odds.
Abilities.
And he wasn't going to give up.
Yeah, but
now
him,
he left the arena.
He ran away.
You know?
Like, I understand you're protecting your wife, but you also can't run away. Like if I'm protecting my girl, I'd rather get my ass kicked and try.
And let her run.
Yeah, I'd rather go down with a fight than to run away. I just thought last night I was just watching like this is
and then you know,
it's just reminding
like
me
movie.
Of like
think of it like if you
when
were in
Mysterio
a movie,
was champion and they had him losing every match.
Think about like a horror movie in real life. If it's a horror movie in real life, are you gonna check the body?
No,
you don't check the body.
I'm in the fuck
you
out of there.
You don't stay in the car till it magically works, and you don't hang around with the black guy because he's gonna die. All right, that's just how
Rusev
it works.
Rusev is gonna kill him.
Rusev is gonna kill him. Well, if Kane's not coming after you, Rusev will. Either way, two big ass guys. That was just my view of
Good
it.
Good thing Rusev didn't debut in February.
Oh, that would have oh my god, that would have been that.
Do you remember when I think it was the King of the Ring tournament? I think it might have been Punk. Was it Punk that I think Kofi Kingston had a match, and he was like, "Oh, if Kofi wins, he would be King Kofi Kingston, but those initials would be really unfortunate."
Oh yeah.
Was it Punk?
I think so.
I think he was commentating at that. Or he was commentating.
Yeah, oh, that was when he had the arm injury.
Yeah.
Right.
And I was like,
I think that was the same episode where Punk was like, he spilled my Diet Pepsi.
Yeah.
Yeah. So that's our take on Raw this week. I'm looking forward to tonight's content.
Mm-hmm.
WrestleMania Rewind, WrestleMania 4, the match that honestly changed my life and made me a wrestling fan.
Which one are they doing tonight?
WrestleMania 4. Savage DiBiase.
They're probably going to focus on the whole tournament.
Yeah, but...
Kind of like they did with Brett. They focused on his two matches.
Yeah. So
I thought last week... Did you see the Mayweather one?
No. I'm looking to watch it before.
It was actually really, like, good. It was...
That's what Malik said.
Considering at my job, I had been watching a whole bunch of Mayweather stuff leading into his fight this past Saturday.
Did he win?
Yeah.
Oh, why did I ask that?
I had been watching him all week already, so I thought... I was like, oh, God, more Mayweather.
Yeah.
But it was actually pretty good. I didn't know that the original match was supposed to be.
It was going to be Sho and Mayweather against...
No, it was going to be... Sho and Mayweather against
Batista
and Ray.
And Ray.
Ray
was that scrapped?
Ray got hurt.
Right, he's not on that Mania. Yeah, yeah, no. Yeah.
And then that was Batista face Umaga.
Yeah. That match was okay.
I think that he fucked up the powerbomb.
Dude's 400 pounds.
It's no excuse.
The wellness policy, that's the excuse.
I thought it was pretty good. I think Mayweather was a great character.
Yeah.
The only problem I had was, like, the beginning of the storyline started off with Mayweather as the babyface and Big Show as the heel.
Yeah.
And somehow in there, Mayweather, he's just a natural heel, so somewhere in there he became the heel.
Yeah.
But Big Show was still the heel, so I think that was the one confusing thing.
And then he won dirty.
Yeah.
I mean, not saying that he was going to win
but
clean,
I mean,
but...
And they go into details on, like, what happened in No Way Out when Big Show got on the knee. He was only supposed to give him, like, one worked punch, and Big Show said, "Don't touch my nose," and he broke Big Show's nose.
Yeah.
And Mayweather ran out of the arena because he thought Big Show was going to kill him.
Yeah.
And then, I guess, finally they calmed Big Show down, and Triple H was like, "No, this is great, this is great." And they convinced...
Because I know Shane came out.
Yeah.
And I remember I was like, when we watched it on pay-per-view, I was like, "Show is going to kill him."
And then they convinced Mayweather to come back, and I think... Then Triple H and Mayweather became good friends because Triple H trained them.
Yeah.
And he's accompanied him to fights in the past.
Yeah, I know that. With Bieber.
And 50 Cent.
Yeah. do you know the 50 Cent Mayweather story?
No, I haven't heard. It comes up on my news, but I haven't
heard. So, this is around the time... This is for WrestleMania 24.
Okay.
Mayweather and 50 are good friends. So, apparently...
Oh, I heard like in the last week, like 50 was taking shots at him.
Well, this was back in 08, 09.
Okay.
Apparently at the time... Mayweather was getting ready for the show match.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, Mayweather gets paid 9 times out of 10 in cash money.
Yeah.
He had a duffel bag with the money for WrestleMania 24 for the job. Yeah. He already got paid. And 50 Cent was supposed to come out with Mayweather at WrestleMania 24.
Yeah.
And he's like, oh, I want to go out with you, but I want you to pay me this. And Mayweather was like, yeah, sure, not a problem. But 50 Cent goes, oh, no, I want the money from the bag.
Mm-hmm.
I want the money from that bag right there.
Yeah.
And 50 Cent, for whatever reason, decided to press the best boxer on the planet. And Mayweather kicked his ass.
Yeah.
Knocked him out, cold cocked. And he did not get paid. And that is why 50 Cent did not come out of WrestleMania 24.
Interesting. And then I know when he was supposed to host a Raw, like, the following year.
Oh, yeah.
He got into something earlier in that day.
Yeah, at Vegas with the gun thing.
And, like, luckily he was there. I mean, I was surprised he even made it.
Yeah, but I heard for the second hour he just walked in.
Yeah.
So that's what happened with that. But, no, but he seems like around celebrities, he's pretty humble. I don't think he's a dirtbag like everybody else does.
I think that's his character. It's his gimmick.
Yeah.
I mean, when I was doing security last year, and he came to my store with Little Kim, and he was really nice. I wasn't at the door when he walked in. I was downstairs, but the other guards told me he walked in and shook the guard's hand. So if I would have been at the door, he would have came in, shook my hand.
Yeah.
So from what I heard, he was really nice to everybody. Like,
yeah.
I saw that he bought like this big diamond belt buckle at my old job.
Yeah.
Probably spent.
God knows.
Yeah.
God knows.
But
But like, yeah, I mean, look. I respect the hell of him. He's a great entertainer.
Yeah.
He's a great showman. Fantastic boxer. As far as I'm concerned, for the modern era, the reality era of boxing, he's the best there is pound for pound. To me, one of the top 10 best of all time.
Oh, yeah.
Of boxers. Sorry. No offense to anybody. But if I don't rewatch it, if I don't watch that one before tonight, I'll be watching it after. Countdown. Greatest Villains. Are you ready for the controversy tonight?
That one's tonight? Greatest Villains?
Greatest Villains is tonight. And when we come back, we're going to talk about the following things. We're going to talk about the Network Clash of Champions. We're going to talk about last week's WWE Countdown. Dying to talk about that. We're going to talk about Seder Mania. And we're going to talk about what makes you less of a fan than everybody else when we return.
Folks, we're back. Like Cheyenne mentioned, a whole bunch of shit we're going to discuss in this last segment. So what do you want to discuss first?
I guess first we should talk about Seder Mania.
Okay.
I really enjoyed the documentary.
I was told by the director we can't mention his name.
His idol. Can we say that?
Yeah, his idol.
And if it slips out, just mute it.
I'll bleep it out.
Bleep it out. I don't care.
I got you, brother.
The bleep will be funnier. No curses will be bleeped, but the idol will be. I enjoyed it.
Uh-huh.
I
haven't seen it since I saw it in that theater in November, so
I enjoyed it. Thank you very much for letting me watch it.
Uh-huh.
It was great. I really, really, really enjoyed getting to know him.
Uh-huh.
On a personal level, felt really...
Seder
really...
or his idol?
Seder.
Okay.
I really enjoyed getting to know Seder
and
the journey and seeing really how he became a wrestling fan, a idol fan.
An
idol mania fan. And, you know, the journey to how he got all his memorabilia and this signed and that signed. And I respected the hell out of his passion.
Yeah.
And... his relationship with his idol.
Mm-hmm.
It's genuine.
Yeah.
You saw it between the two guys, that it's real.
Mm-hmm.
And just how close and, like, their journey and how they, you know, really cool. And for, you know, what really touched my heart was that his idol was like, if I have two of anything in my memorabilia room, you can have one.
Yeah.
And what he presented him with that day that he was at his house, it was just really cool. It was really moving. You know, it was really sad to see that both his mom and dad died at the end of it.
Yeah.
That was really, that kind of like just buzzkilled it for me.
Mm-hmm.
But it was fantastic. If you're a wrestling fan, definitely check it out. And
yeah.
big ups to Sader for changing his life, losing weight, becoming a wrestler.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so I totally, totally, totally enjoyed it. yeah, so I
mean, for what I remember, I thought it was really good. Like, I remember telling you about it when I first saw it, and I was finally able to order it online and was able to get my hands on it. And the director was really cool, so I was able to speak to him, and maybe we can get him on the
show.
Maybe
we can get him on a future show.
Uh-huh.
We've got the Big Al show coming up, right?
Yeah, he actually hit me up today asking if we were still...
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I'm guessing it would be the week after. Damn, that's also the anniversary of Owen's death.
Oh, that'll be interesting. We could do a combo. Yeah. I was talking about that with the guys.
Mm-hmm.
They're actually excited for that.
Yeah.
But yeah, I just, I really genuinely enjoyed it, and it was different. It was something that I just kind of...
Like, I went in not knowing what to expect. It was a Saturday morning screening. There was literally about six people in the theater compared to, I think the night before I saw the Adam Pearson Colt documentary, that one was packed.
Yeah.
And that evening...
The Seven Stages of Hell, right?
Yeah. And then
I have to see that.
And then that evening, I saw Barbed Wire City. Both of those were packed. I guess this one was a Saturday morning. It was 10 o'clock in the morning.
Oh well, that explains.
I mean,
why.
I had nothing else to do. My daughter wasn't with me that weekend. It was like whatever. I went over there. I won that Brock Lesnar action figure, but I enjoyed it.
I mean, now we get to the memorabilia.
Mm-hmm.
Holy crap.
Yeah.
And he's got more stuff than when he was on Confidential.
Yeah.
10 years ago. And
well, I don't know. It kind of seemed like that took place around the time that his idol came back to WWE.
Yeah, yeah.
In 2002 to face The Rock.
Yeah. Now, here is what I didn't like about the documentary.
Okay.
People that know... me know that I collect action figures.
Okay.
And pretty much any notable wrestling memorabilia that I can afford, I'll get my hands on. Not saying that I have a huge collection. My Jax Classic Wrestling figure collection is pretty
amazing.
Impressive, considering the fact that I bought this from regular toy stores. I did not pay above face value, blah, 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 blah. I have tons of stuff missing, and I would genuinely wish I had more stuff.
Yeah.
Now, ask anybody. I, at one point, had my room designed so that everything could be showcased.
I remember. I remember when we first started doing the podcast, I thought we were going to do it in your room. And
yeah.
I was going to use your room as inspiration. If we run out of shit to talk about, I was just going to look around your room and find something to talk about.
Well, when we do the video, so we could do that. Because, you know me, from DVDs to action figure, I know the story behind everything I buy.
Yeah.
And there is a story behind all of it. There genuinely is. Like, the Tully Blanchard action figure that I own, talking about it almost makes me cry.
Okay.
And one day, when we showcase memorabilia, we'll explain why. But I am very proud of my memorabilia.
Yeah.
And I had it there so it could be like, look what I have.
Mm-hmm.
If I was Chris Zader, you know, I would have been like, oh, I've got this. I've got... Show it off.
He's got it kind of hidden in...
No, that's not what bothered me. Oh, it wasn't like we got a tour of the room, Bosh.
Yeah.
I was dying for that. I was dying for him.
He showed a few things.
Yeah, but I was dying for him to give a tour of that room.
Or even if that was like an extra on the DVD.
Yeah, I don't know. I just wish that, and I'm going to ask the director this.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe it's an extra on the DVD. I don't know.
Or maybe playing during the credits. You know how during the credits they show like miscellaneous
things. I don't like when they do that because then the credits
It's a small block. Screen.
Yeah. Or that too.
Mm-hmm.
Which is even worse.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I've got this from my idol in 1987. There's only three of these in the world.
Yeah.
The third time I met my idol, he signed this. He gave me this. Show off your stuff for the film.
Yeah.
You know, you've probably seen it 1,000 times, but guess what?
We haven't.
You know, was, you know, that was my only pet peeve, and I was just, when it was over, I was just like, okay, wow.
Mm-hmm.
It didn't take away at all, but I was like, man, I really want to see that.
Yeah.
I really want
to. And I'll definitely check out the Sheik documentary. I'm going to.
Yeah. You,
so we can review that one. Yeah. On,
so that, I mean, again, I enjoyed the documentary. Much respect, much love to Chris Sater. Truly inspirational.
Did you ever see the first Wrestling World Diaries? The second one just came out. I haven't seen that one.
No,
yet.
I haven't seen it yet.
You haven't seen the first one?
No.
Okay.
I heard it was really good.
I have it on DVD. With Colt? They're both with Colt. The first one is Colt, Daniel Bryan, and Sal Renaro.
Okay.
And the second one is called Cliff Compton and Luke Gallows.
Okay. Okay.
But I can let you borrow it. Frankie makes a quick cameo.
Of course. So yeah, that was the only thing about it I didn't like.
Yeah.
If I ever make it to WWE, become famous, and they do a DVD on me, I can guarantee you there'll be at least two chapters on all the stuff that I'll have by then if I have money.
Yeah.
You know, so, and that leads us to this week's fan question. Does making you have less memorabilia make you less of a fan, I guess is the way to put it?
Yeah, something like that.
Like, because, you know, there's people on YouTube that have all these collections, and God bless them.
Well, even the people that we see, like, at the conventions. That,
yeah.
Like, okay, we had to budget ourselves, and like, okay, we can only get a certain amount of people. There's people that go, they'll get everybody, they'll have like 10 things autographed, every gimmick they've ever had, an encyclopedia, both editions,
which
you gotta
we'll get
sign
to
it.
For the Flair signing in a minute.
Yeah.
Let me tell you something. I pay for WrestleMania by myself.
Okay.
Not one person helped me.
Yeah.
Not my brothers, my mom. Here. No disrespect to them. That's not the point of it.
Yeah, same
that
here.
Was something that I wanted to do and had to do.
My graduation gift to myself when I
graduated. Well, I had to do that. That was a pride thing.
Yeah.
For XYZ reasons. There was a guy on the Flair line. He was online with his mom, his dad, and him. And they each had a thing for him to put for his collection.
Yeah.
But you could kind of tell, like, his dad was paying for everything.
Yeah.
And talking to him while I was, you know, telling him about the podcast and stuff. He had met Taker before, he had met Hogan, he had met Bret before, and it's just like, excluding people that have people pay for it, like, where do you get the money for this, dude? You know?
Oh, even guys, even people that are, like, front row, like the Brock Lesnar guy, or Frank the Clown, like, or the signed guy, all these guys that are at every
Frank
show.
Frank the Clown, though, had a job at WWE.
Okay.
Frank the Clown used to work at headquarters.
Okay, so
he
what about...
He says that in his Twitter.
The Brock Lesnar guy.
He's a fan. Same as sign guy.
Yeah.
Both of which were at Access.
Even a friend of mine, the one that helped me get the tickets, my friend Jose, he was front row at Extreme Rules, at Mania, Money in the Bank, all these pay-per-views, he's always there. And it's crazy.
WWE superfan, you know, I saw him like 3 times.
Vladimir?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I saw him there like 3 times, not just at Access, but at WWE's hotel. Mm-hmm. And of course... He met a bunch of people. He has like 7 or 8 WrestleMania chairs.
Wow. I believe it. I'm surprised he doesn't have 30.
You know? So, you know, when I see memorabilia like that, that just really grinds my gears. Because Jamal Jackson and I were talking about this recently. I got to bring it up. Do you see the guys with the tantrums and then break shit?
Yeah.
Like the DVDs and this and that. And I'm like, dude, what are you doing?
Yeah. Like the one that I imitated after the
Rumble. Yeah, like that. I was like, that guy's an idiot. That guy is a fucking idiot.
Yeah.
You know, so I don't know what it is. And then again, if we had money, Bosch, we would be just as bad. Oh, yeah. Or worse.
Probably.
Or worse. Flair's selling his robes for $25,000 on his website. You think I wouldn't buy 2?
Yeah.
And write which ones I want? Like, I paid $50,000. You better give me the robes I want.
Yeah.
You know, so... I don't know. It just makes me a little sad. Makes me feel like I'm not as big of a fan as
you
I
are.
Think. I don't know. Whatever.
We just don't have our parents paying for us to.
Yeah, we. I don't know.
Most of those people.
We're working hard.
Most of those people.
Not saying that everybody
I mean,
does.
A lot,
you know?
I mean, not like okay. I know it's the cliche, but a lot of them do live with their parents, and their parents pay for all this shit, or they have rich parents and they don't do anything. And,
yeah.
Okay, I have a kid. I have a job. You have a job. You have bills to pay. I have bills to pay. I would love to. There's times where I have to stop myself from going on eBay and buying shit. Or
I you know, I was having one of those hypothetical questions with Xavier and stuff like that. You know, if you hit the lottery and this amount of money and stuff like that. And the second thing I said to him, I said, the first thing I would do is take care of my mom, give her whatever she wanted. Mm-hmm. And I said, I would make wrestling fan history. He said, what do you mean? I was telling Xavier this. I said, I would be the first season ticket holder to Monday Night Raw. I will buy a ticket for every single Monday Night Raw in the year, mm-hmm. and I'll be at every single one. That's what I would do.
You're basically the Brock Lesnar guy.
Yeah.
And sign guy.
Yeah. Fly out every Sunday.
Like, how do they do it?
I don't know. And I want to ask sign guy what he did for a living. But I said to sign guy, I said, hey, man, I didn't see you at the holiday show back at the Garden. He's like, man, it's just getting too expensive there.
Yeah.
That's what he said to me, because he always has floor seats. When I saw
unless he just does TV.
That's what I think.
He's a superstar. He only does TV now. He doesn't do house shows.
You know, floor seats for pay-per-views are $600 now.
Yeah.
But you get a chair.
Even house shows are giving away chairs now.
For the VIP experience. That's only one section of the floor, though.
Yeah, that's... I looked it up and I'm like, that's not worth it. They don't even tell you what wrestlers you get to meet. So, like, what if you go there and it's fucking, like, I don't know.
Someone you don't want to meet. Someone you don't want to meet.
Yeah.
Leave it at that.
Yeah.
Just someone you don't want to meet. When they first started, though, when they were announcing it, mm-hmm. It was a scheduling issue. And I know they stopped announcing it after, like, fans were expecting to meet Ziggler and then it was somebody else. And then the next week. Mm-hmm. There was no VIP experience.
Yeah.
It was just the personal shop area. Mm-hmm. Like, honestly, if you're paying for that, you're only paying to meet the wrestler.
Yeah.
Because the personal shop area, that to me is
like the one that we went to in the Garden in December. Do you know, like, who was doing the...
No. By that time, they had long stopped advertising who the VIP guy was. Mm-hmm. But to me, it's the experience of A, being on the floor.
Yeah.
B, meeting the wrestler. Because...
I mean, if I had the money, I would.
Just because you get a goodie bag and just because you get your own personal shopping area...
And a hat.
Doesn't mean anything to me. Oh, and a hat. And the lanyard.
Yay.
You know, I don't know. Whatever. I'm a crappy fan, I guess. WWE Countdown last week released the 10 greatest tag teams of all time.
I have the list of the 10 teams that were picked.
I don't remember that list. Do you?
Yeah, I have.
I didn't remember it.
Somebody made like a picture with the top 9, and I remember number 10.
Okay,
number 10 was the...
Freebirds. Which, offense, mm-hmm. pissed me off. But you know what? They said it was fan-generated with the hashtags, and I was like, you know what? If it was fan-generated...
And they weren't a WWE team.
Yeah, that does make sense, that the Hardys were, like, top 5.
Demolition 2. Demolition 9.
That upset me. Demolition at 9.
Rockers 8.
And I don't even like Demolition that much.
7 Bulldogs, 6 Dudleys, 5 Rock and Sock, 4 Outlaws, 3 Edge and Christian, 2 Hardys, 1 LOD.
Again, if the fans really did truly vote for it, then that makes sense. Mm-hmm. But I know that when I was watching it, I was outraged. I commented that my mom even disagreed with some of the list and this and that. My mom hates the Dudley Boys, apparently. She didn't like them. I don't know.
Did they threaten to put her through a table?
I wanted to ask her that, but I was like, obscure wrestling reference. She won't get it. But, I got to see NXT last week. Mm-hmm. I just got to see the main event. Apparently, Brodus Clay knocked out 2 of Adrian Neville's teeth.
Okay.
And the week before. And Neville now wrestles with a mouth guard like Angle did. Mm-hmm. I felt good for Brodus Clay because he really played big man really well.
Okay.
I felt like he really shined in the matchup. It was no DQ, but they didn't really do anything crazy.
Yeah.
Adrian Neville did the
flippy thing. Yeah.
Whatever it is. But Brodus Clay had the belt on his chest, mm-hmm. so it was pretty effective. I'm waiting for the Tyson Kidd-Adrian Neville match.
Okay, that should be good.
I don't think Tyson Kidd...
When is that
Kidd,
one? Is that at the...
I don't...
Redemption?
I think it's going to be a takeover.
Takeover?
I don't want to check the next tapings because I don't want to know who wins.
Yeah.
So
I think who's Sammy? Sami Zayn's fighting Tyler Breeze for number one contender.
Yeah, for number one contender.
And I'm guessing the finals to the Divas because Paige was stripped.
Yeah, and I know Charlotte made it to the finals. I think it's Charlotte and Natty.
Oh, okay, that should be.
I think it's Charlotte and Natty. I'm a little sad now because I know Adrian Neville's not going to lose soon. But Tyson losing isn't going to help him after winning in NXT. And then it's like now.
I can see Sami Zayn being the one to beat him for the belt.
Neville? Oh, yeah, for sure. I see what the next NXT pay-per-view is going to be. Mm-hmm. But now I just feel bad for Kid because I want him to get a push. And now it looks like he's going to lose to Neville and then they're going to do Evan Bourne and Tyson Kidd as a tag team. Not saying that's a bad idea.
Oh, yeah.
I just want Tyson Kidd to be, I don't know, successful.
I think we all do.
I don't think everybody does. I don't think everybody cares about...
Apparently everybody that works at WWE does.
I don't think everybody cares about Tyson Kidd the way certain people care about Zack Ryder, even.
Okay.
I don't think that. I don't think...
Because he hasn't been showcased and...
That's clearly why, but I'm not going to sit here and tell you they have the same following.
Yeah.
Or the same level of a following. That's, you know... That's just my
opinion. I mean, I thought even being on Total Divas, that would give him a little bit of a bump, kind of like
he's
the Usos.
He's not on it that much.
Kind of like he was on last week.
He's not on it that much. Cena's on it more than him. Well, I don't know why I said that either. Bryan's actually not even on it that much. When you think about it, he's not.
I think the Usos probably on the most of the guy wrestlers.
Oh, yeah. And now Fandango.
I didn't see this week's episode.
Oh, he's on it quite a bit this season for what I'm hearing. I haven't seen it yet. I do want to see this episode.
I got to check it out. I saw the one last week was pretty funny where Natty and Tyson left Arion and Vinny watching watching their place and they lost the cat and they threw a party.
Did Natty beat them up?
They ended up finding the cat. It was pretty funny. She threw a party, like invited a bunch of people from NXT. The only person I recognized was the big Steve Urkel looking dude.
Oh, okay.
Percy Jackson.
Speaking of NXT, Charlotte's dating a guy in TNA. She's engaged to him.
Who?
The guy who just debuted in some new carnival stable that
with
TNA
Mike Knox?
Has. Huh?
With the Mike Knox stable?
Yeah. Some carnival.
I haven't watched TNA in like
a
couple months.
There's a carnival stable in TNA.
I listened to the like review and Impact, but I don't watch it.
There's some carnival stable and the newest guy has been added. Charlotte is engaged to
There's
him.
Also a new stable with a... they haven't debuted yet, so...
Let's not spoil it for the fans. Let's hear what they say about it, and then I'll agree with them.
I'm going to send Rusev down there to take care of them.
They have like 2 weeks left, right?
I think so.
Who knows with the fucking tapings.
But I hear that one of the guys in that stable actually appears on this week's Legends House.
Yes! I saw that this morning as well. Oh, I got a question for you. And I have to say it in my new gimmick. So we going to TNA or nah?
Nah.
Nah?
No.
Nah?
I don't watch TNA.
I think I want to go.
What? Oh, to the show?
Yeah.
It's like Wednesday, Thursday, Friday tapings?
Yeah. I think I want to go.
We can go. We can check one of them out at least.
Yeah, I don't want to see all... What I'm going to give them is still too much money, and I'm going to buy the cheapest ticket.
I want to go to the first one so that we're not like 5 weeks ahead of what's going on TV.
Yeah. I just want to go to the first one because I think that's the best crowd.
Yeah.
Of those 3 days. But I think I want to go.
I'm not spending that much on tickets.
I don't want to go to the July Raw, to the July House Show.
Okay, neither do I.
I don't want to.
I want to go to the October Raw because it's around.
No, we're going.
Our birthdays,
we're
going.
There's a group.
Yep.
Yeah.
Oh, speaking of Hammerstein Ballroom, in 2 weeks, a little less than two, about a week and a half, we're going to the War of the Worlds, and last week in Japan, AJ Styles won the IWGP
and joined the Bullet Club.
No, he was already with the Bullet Club.
Oh, was he?
I said that on last week's episode.
Yes, he did. I'm sorry. Shit on me.
No, another Japanese guy joined. I saw the match.
That's what I was thinking of. New Japanese guy.
But should be interesting now that it's AJ defending the title. And I guess
AJ Lee?
Okada is going to be facing Cedric Alexander.
It's AJ Elgin and...
It's just AJ and Elgin.
No,
and Okada's going to be in another match.
Right. It's against Cedric. Right.
And then they added a few other matches. Like, pretty much with the rest of the guys.
Yeah,
they did like a six-man.
Yeah.
They threw a six-man in there with the Forever Hooligan.
Yeah.
And
I'm excited. I'm super excited for this whole month.
Mm-hmm.
This whole month is awesome. Bosch and I are going to be at the Ring of Honor show on May 17th doing an autograph signing beforehand. So check us out there. We'll be right outside. Autographs are...
I want to get a Bullet Club t-shirt.
Autographs are $1. Photo ops are free. I think that's fair. And I'm going to be at the Ace Championship Wrestling going to have their next show May 10th at the Knights Columbus in the Wallington Arena. So that's in Wallington, New Jersey. Go to aceprowrestling.com for all the details on that. I'm going to be there signing autographs and stuff like that. So come see me. Got a fantastic memorabilia table during the intermission.
Yeah.
So if you're a wrestling fan, you want some memorabilia, they have got some cool stuff.
Awesome.
I'll tell you exactly how cool. Show's over. We're breaking the ring down, whatever. And we're getting ready to go.
Yeah.
I see my buddy Antoine DeMonico with a magazine in his hand.
Yeah.
He's carrying a mint condition. And I say mint in capital letters.
Mm-hmm.
Mint condition, WWF magazine from 1988, the first edition with Macho Man Randy Savage as the WWF champion on the cover.
Nice.
$5.
It's pretty good.
I wanted to kill him. If I had money, I would have given him 40. I would have said, here's some money, give me the fucking magazine. Just like that. Can't wait to see him next week. That'd be great. What else we got going on this week?
I think that's it. It's pretty dark in here.
Yeah, I just realized The Undertaker is returning to the For Life podcast. Any emails from Paul?
No emails
from Paul?
Not even Paul or Jay.
I gotta
send us an email, Jay. Come on.
Jay, do me a favor. Ali, send an email. The least he could do if he doesn't want to be on the show.
I'd be surprised if he even listens to the show. I don't. He favorites all our fucking tweets.
Oh, he probably just wants a follow for follow type thing then. All right, I got
Ali. If you're listening, tweet us the code word. What should be the code word? I should have planned this out a little bit.
Flock of flamingos.
Flock of flamingos. Tweet us flock of flamingos. We will favorite it just like you favorite all of our tweets. All
right, I'm gonna put it all on the line right now. If you send us a list...
Wait, no, this is... before you start, okay. Did you hear that WWE is now offering $25 gift card for every person you get to sign up for the network? And you can sign up to 10 people, up to $250 gift cards. So every week we should come up with, like, how desperate WWE is going to get for subscribers.
I didn't know that.
They announced it yesterday. Up
until
the end of this month.
I didn't know that. I would have done it when Alex joined. Shit.
Yeah. So how desperate do you think they're gonna get? Like, what kind of crazy shit are they gonna start offering?
No, I think they're gonna do the gift cards.
But which just for fun, let's just come up with like different things. Like, well, MLW VIP Conan offers like strawberry hand jobs from fucking Juventud Guerrera.
No, they don't.
Yes, they do.
Has anyone collected?
He asked me once if I was VIP, and he told me that Juve was on the way. I'm still waiting.
Oh god. All right, here's the thing, guys. I'm gonna put it all on the line right now.
So that's WWE Network.
That's WWE Network. This is For Life Podcast. If you
Let's go.
Us a sincere, and we have to qualify it as sincere. If you, the first person to send us a sincere fan email, will get the following. I am willing to give you a For Life Podcast T-shirt, a WWE action figure. I'm willing to give you a wrestler autograph, an autograph 8x10 of me and Bosch, and a letter from me saying how fantastic you are. That's what I'm going to do. And every week, I'm going to make it better.
You heard it here, folks.
Okay, so run it down again. Send us a sincere email. You're going to get For Life Podcast T-shirt, WWE action figure, a autograph 8x10 from a wrestler, legitimate wrestler, be it current or legend, I promise. 8x10 of me and Bosch, and a letter saying how fantastic you are, and a For Life Podcast business card.
All right.
And that's fair to start. That is fair to start, damn it. Sincere.
That's like 5 weeks in. Come on, Cheyenne.
Yeah. Come on. What more do you want? Don't answer that. Don't answer that. Bosch, if you were to go on the World Wide Web and you want to learn more about us, where could you do that?
ForLifePodcast.com.
And if you had any of the social media things that I do not enjoy, but you wanted to interact with us on Twitter, you can talk to you on Twitter at?
Mine or the show?
The show.
At ForLifePodcast.
If they want to send any hate mail to us on Twitter, where can they reach you?
At I am the Bosch.
If they want to send any hate mail to me on Twitter, where can they send me?
At Ravishing Jones.
If they wanted to see our life through pictures on Instagram, where can they find you?
At I am the Bosch.
And you can find me at Ravishing Jones. We listen to your podcast, let's do it for life, ladies and gentlemen. Social media is taking over our mind. It is weakening the resolve of our enemies and lesser strengthening us as a country. Join us in this movement and add us on social media. Ladies and gentlemen, when we return, we'll figure it out.
What are we going to do when we return? I don't know. Do we have anything to talk about?
Let's predict the greatest villains of all time tonight. Let's do that to close it.
Let's just do it now.
All right, fine. All right, I got to get the nominees, though. I know Heyman, Piper, Rude, Vince, Sheik.
Mm-hmm. I'm just going to pull out that magazine cover with the top villain. I'm guessing Piper 1, Vince 2.
Yeah, Piper's got to get 1, but Vince is easily going to be
2.
2.
Vince is what was that list? The one that I sent you last week? They did the top 50?
What, top 50 what?
The top 50 villains. Remember after we discussed the top
50? Oh, yeah, but we saw it last week, though.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
So, I'm guessing then Sheik. Maybe they'll throw in Sarge. I don't remember who was on the list. When.
Yeah, that's why I'm trying to remember everybody.
Oh, fuck it. We'll find out tonight.
I remember I threw people in that were missing when it first came out. That list, I remember them announcing.
Yeah.
And I was like, yeah, there's a couple people missing. Isn't Heyman on the list?
Probably, yeah, most likely.
I hope so. For the sake of mankind.
I don't know if he's on the list.
Oh. I smell the joint up like cold cuts. Here's the trailer.
For Life Podcast.
I don't think I'm going to listen to Main Event. Watch Main Event tonight.
If anything good happens, I'll go back and watch it.
I'm not going to watch the Cena thing. I'd rather see that on YouTube for sure.
Was that a commercial?
Longhorn Steakhouse.
All right.
$12.99. Entrees, I guess. I've never been there.
I got to stop cracking my knuckles next to the mic.
Plus, it gives you arthritis. Sheik?
Is that Muhammad Hassan's music? Yes.
To the Sheik. To the Sheik, though. It opened up with Sheik and, of course, Rick Rude with Cheryl Roberts next to him. All right, so Sheik, Rude.
That's Muhammad Hassan's music, so he Vince, better be on that fucking list.
Triple H.
You know how Piper, I feel about Muhammad Hassan.
Ted DiBiase, Orton. Punk.
Punk's going to be number 10. If he's even on the damn list.
They didn't show 10 guys, though. Wow. I only said, like, what, 7 names?
Yeah.
Let's see again. Sheik. Rude. Vince. Triple H. Piper. DiBiase. Punk. Orton. I'm missing 2.
Okay. Muhammad Hassan. Okay. So I guess we'll find out tonight. What time is that? 10?
10. And Rewind is at 9, right?
Okay. I'll usually watch them during work, my lunch break.
Yeah, Countdown is normally the one I watch live.
Okay.
And then the other two I'll miss or whatever. But that one's at 10.
That's I don't even think I saw, like, the top three for the Countdown for tag teams. It was
LOD.
Yeah, PNC, parties. And parties was nonsense. I still think the best one was the blunders and the gimmicks.
Yeah, the blunders and the gimmicks are the funniest ones.
Yeah.
For sure. The blunders one was. I'm going to watch that one again.
Yeah.
The blunders one was hilarious. The entrance one was okay.
Yeah.
The entrance one was okay. All right, here we go.
What are you doing now?
What do you mean?
I don't know. Are you watching something?
No, I'm saying let's go.
Oh, you said here we go. I thought you were watching something. All right, well.
I don't have the list, so. Wow, were we recording the whole time?
Yeah.
So everything we just recorded.
Fuck it.
Well, I thought we were rolling now. Okay.
I've been recording this whole time.
I just pulled a Todd Pettengill.
Well, we'll be back this weekend, guys.
Yeah. 2 shows this week for Mother's Love.
Because we missed Sunday.
Yeah, we missed Sunday.
We're going to do a late night Skype session.
Show your mother some Mr. T size love.
I'm going to play that song this week. We're going to have Mr. T's that Treat Your Mother Right.
Treat Your Mother Right.
Somebody call
what's
my
on,
mama.
What's on the network now?
Somebody call my
it's
mama.
It's 8 o'clock. Is that...
Let's turn on the network.
I am going to turn the network on. 8 o'clock. Is that main event? And then
maybe.
I think 9 is rewind, and I think
yeah, main
is
event's
countdown.
On now.
Let's see if Cena's out before we go. How the hell is yours open so fast?
It's an iPhone. WrestleMania
commercial. It's an iPod! Main event. Oh, should I launch the second screen experience while you're watching?
It's a fucking Mania DVD commercial. Anyways.
8 minutes in and already on commercial? They're worse than USA.
Have a great week, guys.
I want to know what comes on. No, we're not leaving yet until we see what comes on. We're not leaving yet. All right, WrestleMania commercial, which will include the Hall of Fame, including the speech of the
Mother
Warrior. Still haven't seen it, just because I can't believe it. You think they'll put the Raw the next night on there with the sad Sting fan?
No, they'll probably just put, like, Warriors promo and...
Yeah. Maybe the video package.
I always thought that the Mania DVD should include the following night's Raw.
They had it on there on one of the Manias.
Even if it's just like a, even if it's like a bonus one with like an extra disc.
Yeah.
I don't see why not.
They used to have Saturday Night's Main Event on them.
Yeah.
It's like, why can't they do that? Your opening contest for Main Event is Ziggler and Swagger, and during the commercial break, it appears that Swagger hip-tossed Ziggler over the top rope to the outside.
Okay.
Yeah. And of course, Zeb Coulter's on commentary.
He did make a when him and Wolverine were making up, he did mention like he was kicked once in the head by Jack Swagger harder than the punch from Wolverine.
He said that?
Remember the kick that gave him the concussion that caused him to lose the title?
Yeah.
Yeah, he mentioned that.
And all now right. Ziggler making a comeback. But yeah, WWE Network, tweet us, talk to us, join the fun and find out what I'm complaining about when the shows are airing. I don't think tonight I'm going to complain, though. This seems to be a difference. I was expecting nonsense for the tag on this one.
Yeah.
I'm expecting a nice, fair list.
Hopefully.
Voted by you all.
Because when you're listening to your podcast...
You're listening to it for your mother.
That was mean.
What? No, that did sound mean.
Rusev Udria. Rusev Machka.